It's time for another unboxing. Welcome, I'm Dr. Plague, and I have here another new oscilloscope. This time, it's a Rigol. Now, you might be wondering, why did I buy this new scope when I just bought this brand new Tektronix scope up here? I spent almost $7,000 on this Tektronix scope after tax, and this new one was under $1,000. There is a good reason why I bought this new scope, and I'll share my reasoning with you after we unbox it, so please, stick around! So, let's see what we have in here. We have a power cord and USB cable on the sides. And the rest of the accessories are back here. And we have the main scope body. Let's get rid of this box. And let's get this thing unwrapped. There we go. I'll extend the feet. This is the Rigol MSO1104Z-S kit, which contains this DS1104Z-S Plus scope and an RPL1116 logic probe, which should be in this box. And we have another box containing the logic probe. Let's open this up. And it's in an anti-static bag. Let's take a closer look at the accessories. We have a US power cord, a USB cable, a pouch with two passive probes, along with a bag of probe accessories and color bands, two more probes, a BNC to BNC cable for the built-in signal generator, along with a second one. This must be the warranty registration. A packing list. I never got one of those for the Tektronix scope. This is the recommended due date for calibration, and on the back side is the certificate of calibration. We have another warranty registration for the logic probe, and this should be the logic probe. Let's see what's all in it. Wow, that's quite a few bags. This is the user's guide. Let's see. Let's open this one. And we have the active logic head. This must be the main cable. It connects the logic head to the scope. And here we have the ground leads. So, these must be the signal leads. Two bags left. And we have a bunch of grabbers that you can connect to your signals. And the last bag contains more grabbers, for a total of 32 of them. So now, why did I buy this scope? What can it do that the new Tektronix can't do? What I want is to be able to decode I2C and SPI protocols. And while the Tektronix scope is capable of doing that, it is an upgrade. This upgrade was supposed to cost around $1,500. And I was going to purchase it until I found out it was discontinued. Now it looks like you can only get it by purchasing the bundle package, which contains about 9 of the previously separate upgrades, and this now costs about $5,000. I'm not going to spend $5,000, especially when I can spend only $898 to get a whole new scope that does all that and more. So I purchased the Rigol. Also, this new Rigol gives you 16 digital channels, which would have cost an additional $2,500 or so for the Tektronix upgrade. So for only $898, I got the functionality that would have cost me around $7,500 additional dollars to upgrade the Tektronix scope. This seems like a no-brainer. So let's talk about this scope. And I'm going to go into more detail than with the Tektronix scope because this one is less expensive and more likely to be purchased by hobbyists. And I'd like you to know what you're getting into if you buy this scope. I'm going to show you the good, the bad, and unfortunately, the ugly. So, first of all, this is the DS1104Z-S Plus, which is a DS1000Z series scope. It's 1 megahertz with 4 analog channels, 16 digital channels, and contains a 2-channel signal generator. This scope takes about 25 seconds to boot up. If we look at the pre-installed options, you'll see that all the options are pre-installed as advertised. One thing to note is that the screen is very directional and can only be viewed correctly by looking down at it. You can see if we look up at it that the grid appears to disappear, so this is not very good for placing on a shelf above the level of your head. What a shame. I usually place most of my instruments on a shelf over my bench, but I would need to stand up to view this scope. Seriously? The colors of the probe inputs on the scope and the traces are yellow, light blue, pink, and dark blue. But the color bands they give are yellow, light blue, pink, and green? They couldn't even get the colors to match? Now, I know I've seen dark blue bands on other Rigol scopes, so maybe they just ran out of dark blue and had to supply green? This might not seem like a big deal, but it can be a little confusing when you're looking at a dark blue trace and you're trying to find which probe matches up to it. Also, they don't give much space to plug in a USB memory stick. If you have a slightly larger stick, like this one from Coilcraft, you'll see that it doesn't quite fit due to this lip up here. And what's up with this outline around the vertical control section? It's drawn right through the source button. None of the other outlines pass through the middle of a button. Did they not want to take the time to adjust the graphics on this scope? Another thing I don't like is that you can't turn the side menus off and use the whole screen for the traces. That's a little annoying. But one of the biggest problems is the sensitivity of the multifunction knob. It drives me nuts because it has no detents, so when you push the knob to select something, you're very likely to change the selection or value before it applies the selection. Also, it will many times fail to detect a push if you don't hold it down long enough. This makes me think that the switch probably doesn't generate an interrupt, so that's kind of frustrating. I'm tempted to go inside of this thing and wire up an external switch to this knob after the warranty period expires. Anyway, let's take a look at the built-in signal generator. Now, in my opinion, this signal generator leaves a lot to be desired, so think carefully before you pay extra for this option. You may be better off buying an external signal or waveform generator. But as long as you are aware of the limitations and it satisfies your particular use case, then by all means go ahead and get it. Now, first off, this signal generator is spec'd to operate up to 25 megahertz. But beware that many waveforms have a reduced frequency. A sine wave can reach 25 megahertz, and I'll try setting it to 26 to show you that it is limited to 25. But let's take a look at the square wave, for example. It can only get up to 15 megahertz. The arbitrary waveform maxes out at 10 megahertz. The pulse is limited to 1 megahertz. And the ramp only gets up to 100 kilohertz. Not very impressive, but that's what you get. You can see in the datasheet under the signal source section that it claims the signal source can provide an offset up to 2.5 volts. But let's check this out. I'm going to set the channel 1 probe to 1 times so we can directly connect the source output to it with the correct scaling at 1 volts per division. Now I'll set the first source to generate a square wave. Now let's try to change the offset, and the parameter is limited. What they fail to tell you in the datasheet, and you can find this out in the owner's manual, is that the offset range is from negative 2.5 volts plus the current amplitude divided by 2 to 2.5 volts minus the current amplitude divided by 2. This means the entire waveform must fit between negative 2.5 volts up to positive 2.5 volts. So if I change the amplitude to 2.5 volts, and I try to set an offset of 2 volts. Then you can see that I'm limited to a maximum offset of 1.25 volts. Another annoying thing about this scope is that there appears to be no way to automatically set a 50% trigger. Most scopes will set the trigger to 50% if you push the trigger knob, but if you push the trigger knob on this scope, it just sets the trigger to 0. You need to manually adjust the trigger. Why no 50%? If you're looking to generate a 5-volt clock signal for digital logic, then this is not the signal generator for you. But if you're using TTL-level logic chips, such as LS or HCT versions, then they should see anything above 2 volts as a high. And we are able to create a clock signal from 0 to 2.5 volts with this signal generator. Beware that HC logic chips have a higher threshold and will not work reliably with this voltage level. So, I'm going to connect the output of this signal generator to the homemade logic analyzer that I made to show that it properly detects the signal with this voltage level. And you can see there is no problem with that. By the way, I do plan on creating a future video showing how you can make one of these homemade logic analyzers that can connect to a TV with a composite signal input. Now, before we continue, I want to show you a little issue on my homemade logic analyzer. I'm going to use my Owan waveform generator to generate a 5-volt clock signal at 100 kHz, and I'll connect it to the homemade logic analyzer. Then, turn the waveform generator on, and notice the result. The beginning of the square wave is all messed up. Now, you might think this is an issue with my homemade logic analyzer. But let's see what happens if we try the same thing using a digital channel on this scope. So, I'll connect the Owan to digital channel 0 on this scope. These are the logic probes, and one problem is that the little stickers on them don't stick and keep falling off. I'll need to find some way to get them to stick a little better. Now, it's important to note that each group of 8 digital channels takes away one analog channel. I would assume that's because each analog channel has 8 bits of vertical resolution, so it makes sense that 8 bits can support 8 digital channels. Now, I'll turn on the logic analyzer. I'll adjust the horizontal scale to 10 microseconds per division, and I'll move the trigger point to the left side of the screen. Then I'll trigger on digital channel 0 and set the trigger mode to single. Now I'll turn on the output from the Owan waveform generator and look at that. The problem is not with my homemade logic analyzer. I'm going to turn off the logic analyzer and let's take a look at this on an analog channel. We can see that there is an issue here. My guess is that this is due to a relay bounce in the Owan waveform generator. My hope was that the signal generator in this scope doesn't have this issue, or is at least a little better. So let's take a look at how it behaves. I'm going to set the horizontal scale to 100 milliseconds per division to show you this. I'll use a single trigger. And turn on the signal generator, and look at that! That's absolutely horrible! Let's hook the Owan back up with this horizontal scale to show you the difference. And look how nice that is! Here's the built-in signal generator again. Let's zoom in a little and show you this monstrosity of a signal. Wow! This is all wacky! Ah, come on! unbelievable. But I guess that's what you get with this scope. Now, let's see how well this transitions from one frequency to another. I'll start with 1 kHz and set the trigger to detect a faster pulse so we can trigger on the frequency change. I'll set the trigger mode to single and change the frequency to 100 kHz. And look at that! There's a significant pause in the transition. Let's try the same thing with the Owan waveform generator. I'll match the voltage and start it at 1 kHz. Now that's a nice transition. Much better. Another reason to consider a separate signal generator. One more thing I want to do is to check how accurate the frequency is in the built-in signal generator. So I want to set this thing up to output a 1-volt peak-to-peak sine wave at different frequencies, and then we'll send the output into a fluke frequency counter. Let's check 25 megahertz. Oops, we need to change it back to a sine wave to get up to 25 megahertz. Let's put the trigger type back to edge. And here's the signal we'll be measuring. I'll connect this up to the fluke and measure it. And that's impressively close. Wow! Let's measure 10 megahertz. Nice! That's about as close as we can get. 1 megahertz. Looking good. 100 kilohertz. Ten kilohertz. One kilohertz. One hundred hertz. 10 hertz. How about 5 hertz? And finally, let's try 1 hertz. Even though the Fluke is only rated down to 5 hertz, it still looks good. So, this does impress me. I'm perfectly satisfied with the accuracy of the frequencies. So, let's take a quick look at the fast Fourier transform, aka FFT, functionality of this scope. I'm going to set this thing up to generate a 5-volt square wave at 1 kHz. Then I'll enable the FFT and set the center to 5 kHz. With 1 kHz per horizontal division. I'll set the unit to volts RMS. I want an offset of negative 1.5 volts, but it won't let me set it to that. I'm going to change the scale to 500 millivolts. And now I can set the offset to negative 1.5. And my window of choice is Hanning. Now, let's turn on the square wave and take a look at the frequency domain. This is looking as I would expect. Square waves contain the fundamental and odd harmonics. The fundamental, aka first harmonic, takes up 6 vertical divisions, so the third harmonic should be 1/3 of that, or 2 vertical divisions, which it is. The fifth harmonic should be 1/5 of the fundamental, which would be 1.2 vertical divisions, and it looks close to that. The seventh harmonic should be 1/7 of the fundamental, or about 0.857, and that looks about right. Then we should have 2/3, etc. This all looks good. So now let's check out the FFT of some modulations. Now, beware that this scope is not going to perform a good FFT with very high carrier frequencies. So, I'm only going to create a carrier at 100 kHz. I'll make it a sine wave at 1 volt peak to peak. I'm going to add an FM modulation at 5 kHz. And a deviation of 5 kHz. And I'll turn the output on. Let's set the FFT up to see this in the frequency domain. I'm going to set the unit back to decibel. I'll set the scale to 10 dBV. Then center it to 100 kilohertz. Give it a horizontal division of 5 kilohertz. And move the offset up a bit so we can see it. The center is showing the carrier at 100 kilohertz, and we can see the sidebands fairly well. A little jumpy, but nice. Let's take a look at a reduced deviation. I'll set it to 500 Hz. Now we can see less sideband frequencies, just as we would expect. And finally, let's look at amplitude modulation. Beautiful! Let's turn all that off and play around a little with the XY mode. For this, we'll need two inputs, so I'll connect the second source to the second analog input. Let's turn on the XY mode, and I'll split the display so we can also see the signals in YT mode in the top half. I'll create a couple 1-volt sine waves at 1 kHz. See how the multifunction knob turned on me as I pressed it? This is very annoying. Now I need to set it again. There, now it worked. Let's turn the signals on and align the phase. When the phases are aligned, we'll see a straight line with a slope of 1. However, if we set the phase of one signal to be 90 degrees, then we should see a circle. Let's play with a little FM modulation. Almost looks like a horse saddle rotating around. Ha ha ha! Nice! One thing to note with this scope is that if you set it up to recall the last settings here with the power set, it will not save the last settings for the signal source. To do that, you need to go in the source menu under recovery calls and set that to last. But it doesn't seem to save everything correctly the way it should. Check this out. I'm going to set source 1 to 50 kilohertz. Not that it needs to be 50, but watch what happens. I'll turn the power off and back on. What you are going to see is wacky, but this issue is not near as wacky as the next issue that I'll show you after this. Now look, it still shows 50 kilohertz. But what happens if I try to increase it with a multifunction knob? What the heck? We're now at 990 hertz. It should have moved up from 50 kilohertz, but for some reason it forgot what frequency it left off at. Now, for the really wacky issue. I'll set the source to 10 kilohertz, and again, this frequency doesn't much matter, but let's check it out. I'm going to add some FM modulation to it, and I'll choose 1 kHz for both the frequency and deviation. Now let's try increasing the source frequency from 10 kHz to 10.1 kHz and watch this. What the heck happened there? What's this? This is crazy. If I turn the output off and back on, then the problem is fixed. I may need to study that wacky signal and see if I can figure out what was going on. Maybe I'll make a follow-up video on it. We'll see. Anyway, let's look at the main functionality that I purchased the scope for. Let's look at the I2C decoding. I'll connect the scope probes for this and connect them to a board that generates I2C signals. I'll need to set the channels back to 10 times. I'll adjust the horizontal scale and adjust the trigger. Then set the triggering to normal mode. Then I'll apply power to the circuit board and see if we can capture some I2C signals. I want to separate the clock from the data signal. And let's move the trigger point back to see more of the signal. Now I'll go into the math menu and select the I2C decoder. And I want to see it in hexadecimal. Then I'll turn the decoder on. And we can see some of the I2C data. We can see a write to the address of 48 hex, followed by two writes of 01 and 81. And just for comparison, let's see how the I2C decoding looks like on the new Tektronix scope that I bought. I captured this before the trial period expired. Well, that's it for our experimenting. So, unfortunately, I discovered quite a few things that I do not like about this scope. But the big question is, would I recommend it? If you are an electronics hobbyist, then yes, absolutely. You get a lot of functionality for your money. But if you are a professional engineer, then unfortunately, no, I would not recommend it unless you have a specific use case for it, such as I have. I only need it for decoding common protocols, and maybe the logic analyzer functionality will come in handy. It's still an amazing value, and if you don't already have a scope, then consider purchasing one of these. It would also make for a great additional scope if you already have one or more and just need another one. Many of the issues that I found could probably be fixed with a firmware upgrade, and in case you're wondering, I do have the most current firmware installed. Maybe in the near future, many of these issues will be resolved, but as of now, mid-2022, there seem to be several bugs, and I'm sure I'll find more bugs as I continue to play around with the scope. But it is still a very usable scope. Well, that's it for today. Please peck at that like button if you found this video useful, and please subscribe if you haven't already done so. Thank you, and I'll see you next time, right here on Dr. Plague.